Why would we at a law school bring Danny Meyer, a famous restaurateur, and two producers, two famous Broadway producers like Rocco Landesman and Jordan Roth, here to NYU Law as part of our mindset, our leadership mindset experience? Because they love what they do, and they're amazing, they're forefront at their industry. And that's what we're talking about. We produce lawyers who are at the forefront of their industries. And that's what we're up to here. We produce lawyers who are at the center of the conversation, who love their craft, and who make a difference in the world.
Danny, let me start with you, because there's a little anecdote in the book. When Union Square Cafe first opens, first year or so, and it's so successful, you finally decide to go out with your wife to another restaurant to celebrate your wedding anniversary. And you get to that restaurant and you sit down, and the owner of that restaurant approaches your table and says, "Why aren't you at your restaurant?" So, and then you say in the book, "I felt guilty about that. Why aren't you at your restaurant right now?" You have restaurants. Are you able to walk away? I mean, how is Shake Shack operating without you? How can anything get done? Are you comfortable walking away during lunchtime?
Are you trying to make me leave right now?
No, I want to know.
You're preying on every one of my paranoid buttons right now.
I think delegating responsibility is an important facet of leadership, and you talk about that in your book as well.
Well, we've come a long way in this industry since 1985, because in 1985, is my mic on? Can you guys hear okay?
Yeah, yeah.
All right, I was going to say, in 1985, the restaurant business was truly a mom-pop kind of venture. In fact, you were expected to never miss a service. You were expected, at best, maybe even to live upstairs. The restaurateur you're talking about was Andre Soltner from Lutece, and he never missed a shift. He did live upstairs. If he didn't want to work, he closed the restaurant. You know what? The first 3 years Union Square Cafe was open, we closed for 2 weeks every summer because I wanted to take a vacation, and I wanted to be like the French guys. But we've come a long way since then. We didn't used to have restaurant groups. It used to be thought of as two completely different camps. You had the chain guys, and then you had the serious guys who had one restaurant. And you know what's been fun about our business is that it's become a valid career choice for people. Quick anecdote. The only reason I went into the restaurant business was because I was afraid to go into your business. In fact, it was the eve of taking my LSATs. I was supposed to be a lawyer, and it was on the eve of taking my LSATs that I basically freaked out. And I was out to dinner with my aunt and uncle at an Italian restaurant on the Upper East Side, and my uncle asked me what was eating me. And I said, "Well, I have to take my LSATs tomorrow." And he said, "Well, of course you do. You want to be a lawyer." And I said, "The problem is I don't want to be a lawyer." And he looked at me like I was completely crazy, and he said, "You know, you're going to be dead for a whole lot longer than you're going to be alive. Why in the world would you do something you don't want to do?" And he was right. And so that Monday, I took my LSATs, never applied anywhere, which is a good thing because I probably wouldn't have gotten in with those scores. And the rest was history. But the restaurant business has become a business. It doesn't mean that there should be an absence of love and care, but all of this is going to tie back to your theme of leadership, because you have to be a leader if you're going to be able to sit here during lunchtime and know that there's a whole bunch of people having these experiences in your places and feel completely comfortable that some are going to be great, some less so, but at least the team there knows exactly what to do.
So let's talk about why Jeannie would have introduced love into this discussion. In this book, the essence of your leadership philosophy is that to be successful in business or leading people, it's not enough, at least in the restaurant business, to just have technical culinary excellence or precision. That it's also important, perhaps even more important, to create a culture of enlightened hospitality. That's how you describe it. And to the best that I can see in the book, one of the themes of enlightened hospitality means that how you make people feel about themselves, whether it's your employees or your customers. And that requires love. And in the book, you talk a lot about hugging. Here's one line that you say, At its best, a restaurant should not let guests leave without feeling as though they've been satisfyingly hugged. Now, I was gonna mention that you never did apply to law school, you did take the LSATs, so you may not know what goes on here. But in law school, love, hugging, and soul almost never come up. It's, I mean, never, and even when it is, it's so obliquely stated, you know, like, love is like, you know, positive affection. Hugging is sort of a non-battery touching. No one actually speaks of these terms, and yet you provide it as the essence of what it means to be in business and to be an effective leader. Talk a little about why this is true.
I just know it's true, that's why. I think that whether it's your job, where we all spend roughly a third of our lives at our job, maybe more, you're looking, here's what I would say. Until about 5 years ago, I always used to get the exact same question, which was, how do you possibly balance your life between home and work? And my answer was always poorly, because that's the fact. When I'm at home, they say I'm not spending enough time there. When I'm at work, I'm not spending enough time there. And I finally realized about 5 years ago that was a lose-lose situation. That's not where the balance has to lie. The balance is that we all have four needs that we can get satisfied at work or at home, but if they're out of balance, you're in trouble. And love is kind of the overarching theme of the whole thing, but you gotta take care of your body and your mind and your heart, your love needs, and your spiritual needs. And you can get those met at work, you can get those met at home differently, but I do think that when people take a job, or when people stay in a hotel, or when people go to a restaurant, or when people go to see the theater, and in fact, even when people hire a lawyer, they're looking to be loved. I think that if you think about, you're looking for a hug. I want my lawyer to be on my side. That's because I need someone additional to be on my side. I want my job to be on my side. I want to go to the theater to take me someplace in my life that could be spiritual, it could be emotional, it could be intellectually, but it could also be something that takes me further love-wise. And I think it's crazy that in business we're afraid to talk about the fact that the experience, you talk about the experience economy, the experience people want is more love.
Rocco, Jordan, do you think that this concept, you're both friends of Danny's, but also you've read the book. Do you think this concept is easily adaptable to other organizational tasks and organizations? Or do you think that this is unique to the hospitality business where, say, a restaurant, of course, you're supposed to be a host, but this wouldn't apply elsewhere?
Well, I would challenge what we think of as the hospitality business. I don't know any business that isn't a hospitality business. The way, as Danny said, I think beautifully, we're all looking to feel something when we go into a store, go into a theater, go on a train, go on an airline, like what, anything that we are looking for as consumers, as business people, as patrons, is hospitality. The question is, what is the authentic voice of that organization, this group of people, that industry, that is their hospitality? We were talking before about the ways in which, so we at Jujamcyn have found our voice of hospitality in the theater, and we begin to see other theaters looking for theirs. And Danny said, it's not just what you're saying, it's the love. It's what, and for me, that is about the authenticity that comes from, this is a group of people who work in an organization who want to create a feeling for the people who come and are part of what they do, either they, because they work together or because they are, in our case, audience members or artists.
I think that we were talking earlier, and Danny just referred to it, that we're experiencing much more, what we're seeing now is much more of what we'd call the experience economy. There was an article in the Wall Street Journal just on Friday saying that the people running the malls now are very concerned that people, that the millennial generation is less and less interested in buying things, cars, TV sets, et cetera. They'll save up money for a trip to Hawaii or go see a Broadway show or have some experience. They're interested in the experience much more than the thing, than the objects. So if you have an economy and really a culture where what's sought after is the quality of the experience, we talk of quality of life, quality of the experience, that plays right into what Danny has been talking about and which we've been trying to adopt. Jordan's been doing it at Jujamcyn. And it has to be authentic. It has to, you have to, the receiver of the experience has to feel someone who cares about it, as Jordan says, that who's internalized it, not who's just putting it out there in some kind of technical manner. And therefore, it's not only something you're providing to your customer a certain way, but it has to be internal in the organization too. Jordan has been very zealous about creating at Jujamcyn an organization where people want to come to work. And people who aren't there would like to come to Jujamcyn to work there. Very important that people want to work for you. And if they're working for you, they're happy working for you. So this whole thing about the experience, this whole thing about creating a loving experience starts right at home with having an organization where from the top down, people feel that they're valued and that people care about them. And that there's, you know, to use a hackneyed term, an esprit de corps. That is not just a term. If that's lived and felt, the whole experience has a continuum and is authentic. And that's what Danny's been talking about and what Jordan's been doing.
But, you know, the conventional thinking on this is that leadership and love are opposite, right? Because leadership is about commanding respect and authority. We don't think of, say, military leadership as having a lot of hugging going on or a lot of love. You know, there are, this is, I think, a unique way of thinking about how to motivate people in a way that isn't, you know, the conventional, you know, authority or yes sir, no sir.
In purely practical terms, in terms of efficiency, if you have a style of leadership that is embracing, it simply works a lot better in terms of getting results for your employees. The Scott Rudin model, where you yell at people, creates turnover. It's a prescription for having lots of new employees coming in all the time, people who don't have a sense of the culture of where you are, of the entity. If you look at Jujamcyn, you'll find in quite a few long-term, I'm sure it's Danny's organization too, long-term loyal employees. And you know that kind of loyalty is part of the love that you're talking about. And it has to be felt through the organization and ultimately creates a better organization.
You ever hugged a choreographer?
Oh, sure.
I've never not hugged a choreographer.
Hugging works, everyone. It works.
Danny? I also, you know, we did, none of us in this room invented the term servant leadership, but it's basically it's the paradigm that works best today. You have to understand that employees have more choices today than they've ever had. If you take my industry, it used to, you know, the French model was always the military hierarchy where yelling was the currency. And the reason that chefs did that, putting aside the French culture for a minute, which was part of the reason, was that you had to work in a good restaurant and have that on your resume if you were gonna make any kind of a career out of it. And that used to be the case. And today, now that there are good restaurants in every city in the world, and now that there are fewer people who can afford to be a cook because cooks' income has risen only by a meager amount in the last 30 years relative to dining room pay, which is a whole other topic. But servant leadership is the only way really to have great people. And by the way, everything I just said about my industry is the case with every industry. No one has to work for you anymore. No one has to work for me anymore. And our first customer really has to be our employees. And servant leadership basically takes the classic organization model. And if you're the boss, you're still the boss, and the ultimate accountability still resides with you. But it basically applies the rules of gravity to power, and it flips it upside down. And it basically means that the boss is now at the bottom of the triangle, not at the top. And when the boss goes to work, the primary motivation for every action the boss takes has to be to serve the people who will then serve the employees, who will then serve the customers, and as opposed to do as I say because I'm the boss. It's my job is to help give you the tools so you can succeed. And when I do that effectively, it should be like creating an electromagnet for the best talent, which should make it a whole lot more fun to play baseball in my dugout.
Well, one of the points you make in the book, Danny, which again upends the paradigm, is that when it comes to running an effective business, the hierarchy or priorities of stakeholders is that your first priority is to the employees, then the guests, and the investors are on the bottom, which just seems counterintuitive. Again, you know, in law school and business school, corporation courses and corporations and in securities regulations, we're constantly being told that what matters is maximizing shareholder value, right? That term of art, right? The duty is owed to the shareholders. And in fact, downsizing, the concept of mass hirings without cause, right, was essentially invented in order to maintain profitability, right? Firing people maintains the profits during down cycles. But you're saying, what you're saying, it may be revolutionary, is that the most important priority is not to the investors, that the investors benefit when the employees are happy.
Yeah, it's just pretty well
by the investors.
Yeah, and just to be clear, it's not a linear one through five list. Everyone in this room has the exact same five stakeholders, and the question is, how are you going to prioritize them? But it's what we call a virtuous cycle, and if you break the cycle at any point, you've broken the whole thing. So we just think that, you know, Adam Smith, a whole lot of years ago, like a long time before I took my first economics class, talked about the investor as being the only motivation for coming to work. If you take care of the investor, everything else will fall into place. And I remember when I was growing up, you know, the newbies started saying, actually, it's not the investor, it's the customer. And I think what we figured out was that the customer should actually come second. And if you really want to have the most sustained customer satisfaction, put them second. Not because you don't care about your customers, because in fact you care more about your customers, but your customers will never ever have, in the aggregate, over time, a better experience than the people who work for you are having. Because the people who work for you cannot fake it time and time and time and time again. And then if you want your, if you're creating a virtuous cycle, which is the opposite of a vicious cycle, where one good thing keeps leading to something even better, of course, if you want the most sustained profitability for your investors, you would put them last. If you want the best outcome for them, you want to have happier employees, more happier guests, a community that loves that you're in their community, suppliers who absolutely love giving you the best product and the best prices and the best service, and then of course you're going to have the most left over for your investors.
Yeah, Jordan, one thing I wanted to ask you, and then you could pick up from there as well, is that, you know, Rocco said that the people that now work for you love coming into work, and that you've changed even the culture of that. And so what were there certain principles that you were using there? Were you relying on setting the table, or were you thinking you must have come in and saying, this is very important? You know, Danny in the book says that he likes to think of his employees as volunteers. Right, thinking of them as volunteers is one way of saying, look, they have options. They could have gone to work anyway. Is that also true in your experience as a Broadway producer?
Well, yes. I think so. We started before we read the book. We started with a feeling. This is what we think it should feel like to come to theater. This is what we think it should feel like to work at the theater. Now, how do we do that? Because this was the feeling that we imagined was nowhere to be found. So we couldn't really look at that theater over there that's making that feeling. How do we figure that out? So we thought, well, where in the world is this feeling? Does this feeling exist, and how do we do that? And the answer was there. That's where the feeling existed. And as it turned out, this was right around the time, I think, that you guys were launching HQ, which is Danny's extraordinary consultancy, helping businesses in other industries find their authentic voice of hospitality. And Susan Salgado is the total rock star who runs HQ.
With is an NYU grad, I might add.
Isn't everyone?
I'm not. But I'm very happy to be here.
Actually, none of you are.
And together, we sort of found our voice, our mission, articulated it, and then figured out step by step, very much using the principles of the book, but also making them our own. Because it's not a script. It's not, when somebody gives you a ticket, you say this. When somebody says they have a problem with their seat, you say that. That's cold. There's no hug there. There's no love there. Here's the feeling.
Sorry.
Here's the feeling we want to create. Here are all of the possible ways you can create it. Now lead. And I think for the result of inverting the leadership pyramid is we are creating a company of leaders, all of us. Because in that moment, when that theater goer has a problem with their ticket, and this happens all the time, I'm not there, Rocco's not there, maybe the house manager may not even be there. The usher who is there is the leader of our company at that moment for that customer. And she leads with her authentic voice based on what we have created as a company. To the money question, it's very difficult to get somebody to get out of bed and say, I cannot wait to go to work and make Jordan money. That's like not a thing that's going to motivate you. I cannot wait to go to work and create an experience for a group of people that they will remember for the rest of their lives. You can get out of bed for that. The money will come.
In terms of hiring decisions, in the book, Danny, you talk a lot about hiring people based on their emotional intelligence. You call it the 51 percenters, that it's 49% is the technical precision of workers, their ability to do tasks, which is important. But you say you can teach people to do tasks. You can't teach them to not be cold, which is really Jordan's point, right? I think the book is really funny too. There's a series of lines that you don't want your servers ever to say, like, how you doing with the lamb? How you doing with the lamb is just a perfunctory thing to say, and it doesn't demonstrate that the waiter has actually watched you, and you're saying what you would say to anyone. Can I take your plate away? And that you're saying that this is not easy to hire for, and that you actually go to some great lengths to locate the very people who actually have, I think you call them a certain kind of caring and graciousness about them. And again, we don't think of that. I mean, we think of hiring people based on their CV, right? We don't ever ask on their CV, how's your graciousness scores? How are your caring scores, are you going to know what to say at the right time so that you don't appear cold, that you appear that you want to be there and you want to, I think the word you keep using in the book is be on your side, stay on somebody's side, I'm on your side. How do you test for emotional intelligence?
I don't know, actually. And if we can figure out how to, By the way, I just want a quick clarification, if I might. So I don't know that much about emotional intelligence, but what we talk about is HQ, as Jordan was saying, hospitality quotient. There is EQ, there's IQ. So IQ obviously measures the degree to which someone's able to learn things. And we think that the we talk about the 51%, which are the hospitality quotient skills, and the 49% are the technical skills, as you had just said. How good you are doing something is, if you could do everything perfectly, which almost never happens, you would, the most points you would get on your test with us would be a 49, which is a failing grade. That leaves 51 for, and by the way, how did you make the recipient of your performance feel? And that's the 51, which is the hospitality quotient, the HQ. And there are six emotional skills that are always present at a very, very high level in people who have a high HQ. If you have a high HQ, or if you have a low HQ, is not a value judgment on you as a person. I have relatives and good friends who have a very low HQ, and I love them to death. I would just never hire them because they're not going to help us to get 100 on our test. So if you have a high HQ, you are somebody who, for whatever emotional wiring reason, is motivated by feeling better yourself when you make someone else feel good. Right? There are people who are like that. And there's six emotional skills that are always present. They're all in your book right there, setting the table. But they're always present at a very high degree. And if we could figure out how to turn this into a digitized test, we can all retire on that, which would be a good thing. We know how to train our team, how to hire for those emotional skills, but we've never figured out how to actually measure through a test. And I guess because I haven't cared that much to do it, but I'm starting to get interested.
In about 10 or 15 minutes, we're going to take some questions from the audience. You should have all received cards. I don't know if you have, and we'll be collecting those cards if you haven't. Our executive producer, Aaron Bundra, will collect them from you. But we still have some more time, so you can think of your questions.
I think the hiring, Danny's touched on this. The hiring is essential. And as far as I know, there is no test for it. It's having the right people in your organization. I can give you a personal anecdote. At Jujamcyn, about the time I left for the NEA, we had an operations general manager person in place who was incredibly efficient and capable at his job, but he managed by the book. His interactions with people were always correct. He was high energy. He was high intelligence. He did all the right things. But in his interactions with people, people were not happy. He didn't treat people well. He didn't treat them lovingly. He didn't treat them as if he cared about them. And I think the most important or first thing that Jordan did was he made it, you know, I was talking about how he's fostered tremendous loyalty in the organization. People have been there a long time, but this was a very important position and he made a change. Tough thing to do, but he felt that at this juncture where we're interacting with our employees, with our stagehands, with our customers, we need someone at that focal point who likes people and likes to engage with people and is caring about them. And he made a change.
Can I just jump in for a second?
Yeah.
You know, as hard as it is to measure the 51%, it's been really, really easy to measure the 49% historically in every business. You can measure cases won. You can measure, if it's a hospital, you can measure cure rates and night stays. And because of that, I think that in our society, we've put an emphasis on the 49% and not an emphasis on the 51%. In the 51%, I bet when you made that change in your organization, it was tough because you can be a high producer by classic terms, but if you're not contributing to why it's fun to come to work, you're actually undermining the very mission of the organization.
It was a difficult change to make.
But I bet your team flourished once you made that change.
Well, and the temptation is there that the main reason is that these things are hard to quantify. And we live in a data-oriented society where tasks themselves are easy to quantify. And so we go to the one hugging and soul and love are immeasurable. And so therefore they become beyond the reach or capacity of administrators to judge it. Speaking of administrators, when it comes to delegating leadership to others, which is why you're sitting here in the middle and others are running your restaurant as we speak, are you interested in mini-me's? Do you have to have someone who's mini-Meyers?
Lord, no.
What are you looking for in the person who's watching the store when you're elsewhere?
Well, we haven't talked too much about culture other than the fact that I'm surrounded by guys who lead the world of culture. But culture is probably the key responsibility of the leader of the organization, which is, I define culture as the way we do things around here. Right. And every family has a culture. Every organization has a culture. Every school has a culture. You don't have to work to have a culture because you have one, whether you know it or not. There's a way we do things around here in this family. The question is it intentional or not? And is the intention an uplifting culture that makes people understand how they should behave when they come to work? So I do have a high responsibility to have a culture that says, when you come here, your first job is to express these four family values. Excellence, doing things a little bit better today than you did them yesterday. Two, hospitality, doing those things in a way that make people feel better. Three, entrepreneurial spirit, doing things in a way that others hadn't thought of yet, but when you do them, they wish they had. And fourth, integrity, having the judgment to do the right thing, even when it's not in your own self-interest. That's my job, is to hold people accountable for that. But within that, I would be the worst leader on earth if I hired a bunch of mini-me's, because otherwise I wouldn't be surrounding myself with people whose skill sets over and above that culture they have to be complementary to what I know how to do.
Right. And that the spirit of that culture has to be internalized in each employee. There's an anecdote I'd like to tell. I remember writing Danny a letter about it after it happened. I was in a Shake Shack near my home in Miami Beach, and Shake Shack is not, high-end Gramercy Tavern. It's fast food. And
no, it's not.
No, it's pretty fast.
When was the last time you said that line moved too fast for me? Come on, it's slow food.
It doesn't take that long. It's a lot quicker than Gramercy Tavern. So I'm there at the table, and you get a little vibrating thing that tells you when your order's ready. I'm there at my table reading my newspapers, and the thing vibrates, and I go up and get my order. Come back to my table, my newspapers are gone. That big thing in my lunchtime is reading my papers. So I said to the woman who was right there, I said, "What happened to my papers?" And which had now obviously been thrown in the trash. And she said something I never expected. She said, "Which papers were they? I'm going to go to the newsstand and get them for you." That would only happen in a Danny Meyer restaurant. I was flabbergasted. I said that wouldn't happen anywhere else. Can you imagine I won't say fast food, any other chain restaurant or any other restaurant of really any kind where someone would say that to you? And I said,
that's culture, and that makes
you feel good. She had internalized it. She had internalized the whole ethos of the place in, this guy's upset, it's our fault, what can I do to make this right? And in her case, it was whatever it takes. I may have to go, three blocks to get the newspaper, but I'm going to do that. That is exceptional, and that is something that's internalized within the organization.
Here's a guy that's written best-selling cookbooks with recipes that, have changed our culinary tastes. And his New York Times bestseller has a photo of a salt shaker that's half full.
51%
full. 51%, exactly. But it's not just the 51%. I think there's another anecdote here about the moving of the salt shaker, which also has something to do with the values and the culture, a certain way that we do things, right? Do you want to tell that story?
If I can do it quickly, because I know that there's questions out here. So the reason the salt shaker is on the cover, there is, when I was a very, very young restaurateur, I went to a steak place called Spark Steakhouse, and the late owner, Pat Setta, had become kind of a voluntary mentor of mine. He just had the best way of teaching, and he took an interest. And one day I went to Sparks. He was kind of like my Yoda. And I was complaining about this problem or that problem, and what do I do about it? And he put the salt shake. He said, "Here's a salt shaker." He said, "Where do you want that salt shaker?" And I said, "What do you mean, at Union Square Cafe?" And he said, "Yeah." I said, "Well, it's supposed to go in the middle of the table." So he put it in the middle, and he said, "Is that really the middle?" And I said, "Actually, it should have been." And he put it a little off center. I said, "It should have been right here." And he pushed it. And he said, "Is that the middle?" And I said, "No, it's right here." And he kept doing that. I'm kind of like, "Oh, this is a fun game. what are you trying to teach me?" And what he was basically saying is that whatever it is you do, you have to know your center. You have to know where you want it to be. And the minute you're willing to give that up, you've given up everything. And that he basically said, the people you're complaining about, your waiters aren't doing this right, the cooks aren't doing that right, the guests are not showing up for reservations. He said, everyone in life, their job is to push the salt shaker a little off center. Your job is to just push it back. And you should not waste your emotion getting angry with people for doing their job. You know, life happens, and just keep always pushing it back. It was kind of his theory, it was kind of his version of the cracked window theory, which is that if you let that salt shaker get a little off center and that's acceptable to you, it'll just get further off center and further, and it gets increasingly tough to push it back. But if you stay on top of that and you constantly communicate where the center is supposed to be, whatever the task is, that's what it is. So that's why the salt shaker made the cover of this book.
And that's why Sparks became the place for mafia executions.
Because they like to finish the job. Sleeping with the fishes.
There was a famous one there.
Yeah. He was a good guy to have on your side, believe me.
So let's take some questions from our audience. This is for you, Danny. Which leaders do you admire within or outside of the hospitality industry?
Well, this is going to sound like I'm kissing rear end right here.
We're hoping that you will.
Well, these guys, look, I think there's... It's an amazingly brave thing to take an organization that's in a commoditized business, which we all are. I'm a commodity. I'm really, really proud of our ribs at Blue Smoke, which Rocco introduced me to, and I'm proud of our roast chicken, and but it's a commodity. You can get that in a lot of different places. When was the last time you went to a theater and said, "I'm going to go to a theater based on who owns the theater"? And it's an act of courage to say, "I'm going to run my business on a foundation of authentic hospitality and love." We see this in the airline business. It's a commoditized business, right? The 49% of an airline is get me there on time, alive, and get my luggage back.
As cheap as possible.
Right. And the 51% is, and by the way, how did you make me feel? And I'm watching the leadership at Delta Airlines right now. I'm not just saying this because they're a customer of Hospitality Quotient, but that helps. They are truly making a difference. Look, they fly thousands and thousands of people. There's going to be bad experiences, but their batting average is I think, higher than I've ever seen it. And I think that when you look at companies that are truly leading from servant leadership, putting their employees first and understanding that that's how to drive that virtuous cycle, I love those companies, and I wish I could just have a whole stock portfolio of just investing in companies just like that.
You can. That's the next chapter.
It's actually a very cheap stock.
Two of the questions were really comments, and I think I should at least acknowledge this. Two of the people wanted me to announce that the former dean of this law school, John Sexton, was a hugger. And they wondered why I didn't know this, because I was for 23 years at Fordham, and the priest never hugged anything.
Well, yes,
just saying, I just assumed that, but I did not know. I apologize. We do hug here. I was wrong. This is interesting, because I wanted to also talk a little about an area in which you've become part of the new cultural fabric, the no tipping hospitality only policy that was initiated with all of your restaurants, and it's related somewhat to this question here. Does love and leadership impact only the intangibles for employees, such as workplace relations, or do you think it must also be conveyed in workplace policies like salaries, sick days, and benefits? It's a very good question, and I suspect is one of the reasons why you were motivated to change the create a no tipping policy.
Right, so we started that in November at the Modern. We called Hospitality Included. And we made a statement that we would roll it out to all of our businesses by the end of 2016. And we will, assuming the Modern continues to go as well as it is. We do have plans to do it in a second restaurant in February, but we're learning as we go. And the motivation was manyfold. Many of you may or may not know that when you leave a tip, that tip is actually only going in a tiny portion to the person you gave it to, because they are typically sharing it with every other tip-eligible employee. So if you leave a $20 bill on the table, maybe 30 cents of that is going to the person you left it with. What you may also not know is that none of that tip may be shared with anyone who does not, by law, anyone who does not spend at least 80% of their time face-to-face with guests, i.e. cooks, dishwashers, reservationists, et cetera. And so hospitality is a team sport, and the American tipping system has completely become broken, because if you look at just the 30 years that I've been a restaurateur, look at the tip as being a multiplier, and the multiplier is multiplying the menu price. Well, obviously menu prices have gone up about 250% since the time that I got into the business, for a lot of reasons. Rents have gone up, food prices have gone up, linen, everything has gone up, insurance has gone up. So menu prices have gone up, but so too has the multiplier. It was 15% when I got into business. Then New Yorkers tipped 17.5%. And now they tip 20 to 21%. So now it's 21% times much higher menu prices. And so a tipped employee today, good news, can make about 350% of what they made 30 years ago. A non-tip eligible employee is making about 30% more. So it's nearly impossible to live in New York as a cook until you become a chef, which is, you know, it's like landing a role in one of their plays. A lot of good actors, but very, very few get to that level. And so it's broken, because in many restaurants you have a completely different compensation structure. So we got to the point where we said, we are not in integrity as an employee-first company if it's employee-first for compensation, only for part of the team and not for the other. And we looked for legal ways to try to tip the balance, i.e. paying for people's Metro cards if they were in the kitchen, or, you know, trying any way we could. And we finally said, we've got to break the tipping system, because the tipping system is what prevents us from being able to pay in a much more equitable way. We're not looking for parity. I don't think there's any business on earth where the sales team doesn't make a little bit more than the manufacturing team, but the scales, you will not have great food in New York City if this system continues to perpetuate itself. So we're trying this out. We're trying some voodoo economics, which means that we don't want our waiters to make less in order for our cooks to make more, and we don't want you to have to pay more than, or much more than you would have paid even if you were a 21% tipper. And so this will work over the long term, we think, because it'll help us to attract better cooks who will not have to leave our restaurant. Cooks are leaving restaurants to get 25 cents more per hour somewhere else. So our cooks are now making $2 more an hour. And for the first time at the Modern in 2 years, we have a backlog of cooks as opposed to a shortage of cooks. And so to the person's question, of course, we've had sick pay for quite a long time. We've had health insurance forever. And you can't say you can't just be nice to people, because if they can't pay their rent, that's a problem. But it's a whole system, because you know, by going sort of first on this whole thing, our menu prices look higher than other people's menu prices. And if we get that too far out of whack, you may say that's nice that in addition to caring for plants and animals, you're now caring for people. But I can't justify paying $32 for chicken at your place when it's $26 everywhere else. So,
the one of the things that comes out of the book, and then we'll take one last question, and we'll say, and we'll enjoy actually an incredible reception that's catered by the Union Square Cafe Events Group. So you'll be tasting Danny's food soon. But the book is also very much a memoir of your life. And it's an interesting life you've had. And one of the things that it suggests is that you were destined to do what you're doing, that everything that you picked up along the way, from summer camp to trips with your parents to relationships with your grandparents, the relationship with your dad, being a St. Louis Cardinals fan, everything plays in to some degree in how you ended up becoming a successful leader. And I'm also wondering whether Rocco and Jordan can also say that your backstories actually ended up being responsible for how you eventually became the leaders of your organizations. Is that true of both of you as well? Danny doesn't say it directly, but anyone who reads the book, it's clear that everything that happened to him somehow got incorporated, including mistakes. Danny says, all the mistakes that I made along the way made me end up more successful.
What I especially love about his book is, first of all, it is personal. That's the reason it's readable. It's very personal. You have a sense of how he became who he became. And he talks about his mistakes. He talks about things that he screwed up very unabashedly. And I think that's a great aspect to it. I think everyone has their own personal leadership style. It's not the same. Mine's and Jordan's are completely different.
Even though you both at one point ran the same organization.
Yes. Jordan is much more concerned with the micro and the day-to-day than I ever was. Jujamcyn's staff gets together for meetings continually as one way of fostering a continuity and community in the organization. I was meetings averse. I had a completely different personal style than Jordan, but I think in our ways we did want to build an organization where people wanted to work, where people were happy to work, loved working, and I think you can go about it through different ways through who you are and come out to the same place in the end.
Jordan, your story somehow has the reason that people wake up in the morning who work for you and don't think about how they're making you money. Is that something that's somewhat related to how you were raised and experiences that you had?
Well, I think everybody who works in the theater in any capacity does so because at some point in their lives they sat in a theater and they were changed. Mm-hmm. And they said that. What's happening up there? And what I feel right now is what I want to do. And then you go about, so you know the room you want to be in, and then you go about finding what your place in that room is. So yes, but not just for me, for everyone in our organization and in our industry. And I think that's part of what, for us, allows it to be joyful. Because we know what that thing is, we know what it feels like, and we're going to give it to you tonight.
If you love what you
and
do.
And to you tonight.
If you love what you do, it filters down through the whole organization. It's essential.
All right. Oh, go ahead, keep going.
No, so for me, it's wholly selfish. It's, this is how I want to feel when I come to this place that really matters to me. Mm-hmm. And I bet you do too.
All right, last question. It's kind of from the audience.
Can I just add to
that?
Oh,
yes,
real quickly?
Please.
Because
one of the points I'm trying to make is that the hug is completely selfish because you can't give one without getting one. Unless the object is a tree, I guess. But
well said.
That's right.
All right, this is an obligatory question. It's the last question. I have to take this one. Let's frame it properly. The person wants to know, what advice would you give to young lawyers about developing leadership skills? Now, mercifully, none of you are lawyers, but you deal with lawyers. And there is not just the exercising of leadership, but also the giving of advice to leaders. And clearly, you've consulted lawyers in the past. And do you think that lawyers are trained properly, or your lawyers, to sort of deal with leaders in giving them the advice, not just legalistic advice, but advice that a leader should be able to incorporate in making good decisions? What do you think? It's a loaded question, but no one here will be offended.
Well, Danny put it well, you want to feel that person's on your side. You know, the big question with a lawyer, or even doctors or other people in service organizations, is what they're doing truly in your interest? Are they trying to run up hours, or are they really concerned with your needs and your welfare? And that's something that's essential in that relationship.
We have several different lawyers, and I love them. And it's because they are our partners, and they think like that. They don't talk to us as vendors or tacticians. They're partners. They know who we are. They know what matters to us, and they know why. And they have a place at our table.
Thank you so much for joining us with this inaugural series of the Leadership Mindset. We're planning on having others throughout the year, and we hope to see you here for that. Very soon, you're going to be enjoying the food of the Union Square Cafe events people, so you'll enjoy that as well. I want to thank our guests, and before we applaud, you'll see as we leave, we'll be hugging. Just to, in the spirit of this.
Well, now we have to.
We have to be hugging. Rocco Landesman, Danny Meyer, and Jordan Roth. Thank you all.